I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Amen. Let's come together this morning to worship and praise and honor Jesus and get excited about who he is. Know that we as a church need to awake and arise to his presence. Father, we just give you praise and we give you glory. Lord, right now in the name of Jesus, let this place be a place of praise. Lord, let your house be full of praises to the King. And Father, that we would give you glory, we would honor you, we would magnify you, we would lift you up, and we would say, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. And Father, right now, we just give you thanks and we give you praise. As we open this time up before you, in Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Amen? Amen.
This is Isaiah 26:3. You will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. Jehovah will preserve him in contentment whose motivation stayed on Jehovah because he relies on you. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. Everybody ready to sing? I'm still a hopping. So go ahead back there.
Splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. Trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, we'll see how great is our God. Beginning and the end, the Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion. Our God. is our God, and all will see how great, how great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands before them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. If you've been forgiven, if you've been if you walk in freedom, if you bear his name, sing the song forever to the Lamb. And we'll sing the song forever and amen. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy. You are lifted high, holy, holy forever. Hear your people sing, holy, to the King of Kings, holy. The highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all powers and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy,
I walked through the door. I sensed His presence, and I knew this was the place where love abounds. For this is the temple Jehovah God abides here. We are standing in His presence on holy ground. We are standing on holy ground, and I know there are angels all around. Let us pray. Presence, there is joy beyond all measure, and at His feet, peace of mind can still be found. If you have a need, I know He has. Reach out and claim it, for we are standing on holy ground. We are standing on holy ground, and I know there are angels all around. Let us praise Jesus now. We are standing in His presence. We are standing in
standing on holy ground this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, we glorify Your name. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, Lord of glory, fill this place this morning. Lord, hallelujah. Lord, right now in Jesus' name, let the power of your presence overwhelm us this morning. Let your glory come down upon us this morning. Lord, let your light shine through us this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, we give you praise. We give you praise. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. Our God's good. Amen. I'm excited about that. I encourage you all to pray. Especially tomorrow, for this nation. I believe God is calling this nation to repentance. Not only do I believe it, I'm seeing it. I'm also seeing that God is calling this nation not only to repentance, but God is calling the church to repentance as well, that we would get to the point where we would understand that we're not able to play games any longer. Time's too short. But the God of this world wants to defeat the God of eternity. But I've got news for him. He's fighting a losing battle. But his church needs to wake up. His church needs to wake up. We need to wake up to what Jesus has. I want to make you a reminder this morning that as of now, the plan for next week is Big Mo's going to be here at 10 o'clock. We're going to gather together and we're going to, as of right now, have a video. Big Mo is going to do a little video so that the internet will be able to get at least something next week. We cannot put the live service time on the internet because of copyright laws. It's just amazing what they want to do, but that's all right. The word of God is going to go out, and I love it when he speaks, or either him or Jeremy, and gives us a word from the Lord. Amen. I realize Big Mo's in the entertainment business, and I understand that, but I also understand that he's in the soul-saving business too. And the side that we don't often see of him is the side where he ministers the word, and he does it correctly, which is an exciting thing. So next Sunday morning, be prepared. 10 o'clock, we're going to be doing that, and then we'll go into our regular service at 10:30 in service time. So I don't know what he's going to do, whether he's going to speak once or twice or whatever, but we'll let the Lord handle that. Amen? How many of you have ever heard the word sleeping giant? Sleeping giant. As I was praying about what I was to bring forth this morning in our service by way of the word, I heard those two words, sleeping giant. And as I began to ask the Lord, what are you talking about, Lord? Why are you saying sleeping giant? And the Lord spoke to me, and as it were, and it seemed like he was saying something of beauty in that he was speaking to me about, we've just went through Easter, and we get all excited about Easter. about the newness of life and the resurrection and all that, and we ought to. But we're a week after Easter, and what are we doing? Because Easter, and a lot of people who say they are believers' lives, is nothing more than a little emotional high. And when you come off an emotional high, what happens? A low. So this week, a lot of the church is going like this. Boom. And the Lord said, no, that's not the way it should be. It's time for the church to come alive. It's time to come alive. The Old Testament says, awake, O Israel, put off thy slumber, and the truth shall set you free. There was a movie with a phrase not too long ago. I didn't see the movie. I just have heard the phrase forever and ever and ever. Because they used it. You know what that phrase is? You can't handle the truth. And folks, I believe that most of the church today cannot handle the truth because they will not walk in truth. And they are a sleeping giant that needs to wake up. And I asked the Lord where I need to go to, and he took me to Colossians chapter 2. And saying this to me, he said, Jesus has disarmed principalities and powers by his resurrection. He's disarmed all those. We're going around like the devil's got all kinds of ammunition and we're trying to shoot back with a water gun or a pea shooter. It's the opposite. God has disarmed the enemies and we need to stand up and become bold. Be bold. Be strong. For the Lord thy God is with you. And I began to look at that thing. And then I began to ask God, what are you saying in Colossians chapter 2, verses 13 to 15? Look at this. And you. Say it. And me. Me. This is to you. And you. Being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has made alive. Say this, I am alive this morning.
I'm alive this morning.
How about that? Let's get this together. I'm alive. Hallelujah. You sound like people or me before my morning coffee. We need to get excited about who. I am alive. Come on now, let's try it again. I am alive. I have a reason. I am alive. He's made alive together with him, having forgiven all your trespasses. Thirdly, I am forgiven. There's no shame in me because the Lord took my shame. We just celebrated the cross and the resurrection. It's time for us to understand to get off the cross and get on to resurrection. The cross is a beautiful thing. But it wasn't meant to last for eternity. It was meant to bring us into resurrection. And as I began to look at that some more, the Lord began to speak to me. Even more. All my trespasses are forgiven, having wiped out the handwriting of the requirements that was against me, which was contrary to us. That's a shame. Now, I know you don't have a physical rag this morning, but I want you to act like you have one in your hand. And I want you to just wave it and wipe out that all that guilt, all that problem, all that unworthiness this morning is wiped away because Jesus took it. We don't need to hold on to it. All of it's gone. He nailed it to the cross. Having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. Folks, I just have a few things I want to say this morning. The first one is you have been made alive together with Christ. You're not on your own this morning. How many of you have ever felt like you were on your own? You were in a cage. You couldn't trust anybody. You just didn't know what was going on. And you felt so isolated. Jesus took that. Jesus took your isolation and gave you his presence. You walk in the presence of Jesus this morning. I was asked to write something up for some folks. About a mother who passed away. And I began to write. And the only thing the Lord gave me was this. And I believe I said it Wednesday night, and I'll say it again this morning. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. My question this morning is, which Lord are you serving? Which Lord are you serving? And I begin to do something. You've been made alive together with Jesus. And look at this. Jesus has spoiled or disarmed principalities and powers. I want to take that word disarmed. He's disarmed. The word means to be spoiled. How many of you, I know it happens to us every once in a while, have something in your refrigerator that gets moved somehow to the back of the refrigerator and you don't find it, and all of a sudden you open up the refrigerator and you say, "Ooh, this smells." And so it begins a search for the smell. I mean, you know what I'm saying? For what is rotten, what is spoiled. Listen to me. Excuse me. Mary, can you do me a favor? Thank you. Excuse me this morning. Jesus has disarmed. The principalities are spoiled this morning. They are spoiled. They're rotten. Why do we accept the wiles of the devil when we wouldn't accept them in our refrigerator? I don't know how many of you have... Thank you. I appreciate that. I don't know how many of you have ever, went into your refrigerator, and this happened this past week to me, where I opened up something that I thought was good, and it was all furry. You know, you understand what I'm saying? Well, let me tell you something. The wiles of the devil are rotten. They're no good. They're moldy. But we accept them anyways. And I began to look at that, and I began to see what the Lord say. He spoiled those principalities. That word spoiled is disarmed. He's disarmed them. They have no effect. Excuse me. They have no effect. Principalities. What are principalities? They are the powers and the authority of the enemy. Would you just say something, to turn to somebody and say, the enemy has no power or authority over me? Just do it. Now, what you said is true. Do you believe it? I once heard it said that a lady came to a pastor and said, "Pastor, I need prayer. The enemy's been chasing me all week." And the pastor lovingly told that lady, "You don't need prayer." And she was shocked. But then he said this. He said, "You need to turn around and tell the enemy to knock it off, that he has no authority in your life. You need to come against it." Powers, he spoiled them, he's disarmed them. The enemy has no power. He has no authority. Who has the authority? Jesus. When he went down to hell and he reached down and picked up the keys to heaven and earth, he took all the authority away from the enemy. And then what did he do? He turned around and he gave them to you and I. Powers. I love this word powers because I'd never seen this before, but as I read and as I studied it out, I seen it. Powers are privileges, jurisdictions, and rights. Privileges, jurisdictions, and rights. The devil will tell you that he has jurisdiction over you. He doesn't. He will tell you that his privilege is to lord over you. He doesn't. He will tell you that it's his right to destroy your life. It is not. Because Jesus spoiled all those. And when he came, he gave us the privilege to walk and be united with him again. The jurisdiction is in the resurrection, not guilty. And the right is for us to enter boldly into the Holy of Holies. Understand, we need to understand what we're holding. We are holding something powerful, something real, something magnificent. We just need to tell the enemy and Satan and the demonic hordes that would come against us no more. No more. I believe God. Amen? I come against those things. And I begin to look even further. Jesus, listen to this, and the Lord gave me this. Jesus, through his resurrection, has shown the failure of the enemy. He made a show of them openly. He made a public spectacle of them. Jesus has shown the failure of the enemy. How did he show the failure of the enemy? Through his resurrection. Now let me say this. Listen to this very carefully. Because this may be a little bit much for you this morning. But listen to this. Jesus showed the failure of the enemy through his resurrection. We need to show the failure of the enemy through believing that he is resurrected and he is alive and made us alive. You need to tell Jesus, Lord, thank you. Thank you for making me alive this morning. Thank you, Lord, for walking with me, moving in my life. And the fourth thing this under this point about Jesus has spoiled the plans and disarmed the principalities and powers is Jesus has given us an ability to triumph. An ability to triumph. I looked at this, and that word triumph, especially. And as I studied this word out, it kind of got me. How many of you want to know about triumph in your life? Here it is. The word doesn't mean that we triumph, that we can stomp all over the enemy. We can tell the enemy what to do. The word means to attach ourselves to Jesus. Giving us the ability to attach ourselves to Jesus, to triumph over the enemy because we are attached to Jesus. I was reminded about times that Becky and I have went out to places to eat or to something like that. And we'll be with other people and they'll say, well, the check's mine, check's me. And they get to Becky and I and we hadn't sent anything. And the waiter or the waitress will say, are you two together? And I'll turn around and I say, yeah, for about 45, 46 years, we've been together. And longer than that, if you take all the time that we dated. And I looked at this. Is the world, and here's, listen to this, is the world coming at you, and when the enemy asks you, are you together with him? What do you say? No, I'm alone. No, I'm attached to Jesus. I'm attached to his presence. We have attached ourselves to him. He's attached himself to us, which is better phrasing. Attached. The marriage supper of the Lamb. The church is the what? Bride of Christ. We are attached to Him. We're attached to His presence. If you have your Bibles, turn to Romans chapter 8, verse 31. You are attached to Jesus. And because you are attached to Jesus, listen to this. If God be for you, who can be against you? Is God for you this morning? Yes. Who can be against you? I want to just look at this for just a moment. Romans 8, 31 through 34. Actually, we're going to go through 35 but and 36, but we'll deal with that. What then shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare His only Son, but delivered Him up for us all, how shall He not with Him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died, and furthermore is also risen, and even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Look at this. If God be for me, who can be against me? He did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for me. He delivered him up for us. And on top of that, he's invited us to be attached to him and freely receive of everything that he wants to give us. Give us all things. Take authority this morning and do not let the enemy tell you that you're second class in the kingdom of God. Because he has no authority. He's risen. He's at the right hand of God. He's making intercession for you and I. I was studying out this, and Friday night, I was having a conversation with Donna. Actually, it started Wednesday night at church, when we had a little time together, and Donna talked about some of Derek's friends, and I happened to say, well, that's Derek. That's just Derek moving and interceding for those people up in heaven. See, let me tell you something. And I'm going to tell you this just flat bluntly. If you think you're going to heaven to tiptoe through the tulips, you're going to the wrong place, because God has a mission for you. And I believe one of the things that Derek is doing is the same thing Jesus is doing for you and I, and that is he is interceding for those people who he witnessed to who have not come to meet him yet, but he's saying, okay, God, I'm here now. And you know Derek. Derek didn't quit. It just went, His attitude was very simple. Keep going, keep going, keep going. And I believe just because he left this world doesn't mean he stopped. He's going. And it's being accomplished because now Donna has to deal with it. Aren't you glad? Donna's thinking, oh no. But let me tell you something. God is doing a bigger thing. He's given you all things. Some of us need to just write down, memorize, and quote Romans 8:33 every day. What is it? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. When you're feeling the pressure of this world, you need to turn around and say, who shall bring a charge against God's elect? I am God's child. I am God's elect. God has justified me. He has made me a child of the King. You can try everything you can, but I am not guilty according to God. I'm not guilty. You're not guilty. It is Christ who died, and furthermore, who has also risen, and even at the right hand of God, who makes intercession. God's making an intercession for you. Let me tell you something. The evilness of this world and the evilness of the things of this world and the evilness of the people of this world, God has seen. And he's saying, that's my child down there. You can't mess with him. Why? He has put a hedge of protection around you. If you look all through the Bible, the children of Israel were protected from the plagues. God protects them. There's an old chorus that says, God leads his children along. Some through the valley, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. You are covered by the blood of Jesus this morning. With that, I will say this. It's not a bad thing, and this is just off the message, but it needs to be said. It's not a bad thing for you to take oil and anoint the doorpost of your house at least once a month, and sometimes more. Sometimes we've got to do it every day. When the enemy comes against us, keep coming against, we just got to say, okay, no more. You're done. This is God's place. This is God's place. This is not a once and done thing. We need to be continually covered with the presence of Jesus through the blood. And I begin to go on more for more than that. One more scripture, and it's 8:35 through 37, and then we'll be done. I told you it was going to be shorter this morning. You didn't believe me, did you? Jesus has made us more than conquerors through Christ. You are more than a conqueror this morning. You're not just an overcomer, you're a conqueror. Turn to somebody and say that. I'm not just an overcomer. I'm a conqueror. I don't want to just overcome to have to overcome again and have to overcome again. I want to conquer. I want to destroy that thing that would come against me in the name of Jesus, so I can move on to bigger and better things. Oh, he'll try to keep coming back? No. You've been conquered. You've been conquered in the name of Jesus. Romans 8, 35 through 37. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? What's separating you from Jesus this morning? Hear me? What is separating you from Jesus this morning? What is separating you from His presence? What is separating you? Is it tribulation? Tribulation, is that separating you? If tribulation is separating you from the presence of God, if your problems, if your situation is separating you from the love of God, then dare I say that you're still part of the sleeping giant. You need to wake up. Shall distress? I'm in distress. I don't know if you realized it or not, but I'm realizing it because I watch DIY Network, Do-It-Yourself Network. You know what's in today? Distressed furniture. I watch them take a brand new, beautiful piece of furniture. And the guy took a chain and he wrapped it around his hand and made a whip out of it. And he beat the daylights out of that dresser. And he said, I'm distressing it. And I began to look at it and said, yeah, you're distressing it all right. And I kind of got upset because in my mind, I thought, if you want a used piece of furniture, go buy a used piece of furniture. Don't wreck a new one. And then the Lord said, you don't get it, do you? And I said, well, what do you mean? He says, all my children are distressed. And I said, huh? He said, all my children are distressed. They bear the mark of Christ. You bear the mark of Jesus Christ. You bear His presence. That means that in my life, because He went to the cross for me, I bear His scars. Because He died for me. He scarred Himself for me. By His stripes, we are what? Healed. You following that? And some of you may have a problem with this, but that's the truth. I am attached to Jesus. And because I'm attached, all the distresses of this life, all the things that this life are nothing. Because Jesus, listen to this, has made me into His image. I'm growing into His image day by day. Therefore, I bear the things. Paul said it himself. I bear the mark of Christ. And I began to look at these things, and I began to look at these things and think. Third one, persecution. I'm so tired of the Christians being persecuted. Get used to it. Get used to it. Why do I say that?
I say that because if the devil's already, if the devil's not persecuting you or coming against you, he's already got you. Do you understand what I'm saying? You're in a war zone. I spoke about the eclipse. And it's interesting. It's going over Nineveh. It's called the Judgment Eclipse. In some of the churches named it the Judgment Eclipse. Go over Israel. Repent, repent, repent. Repentance. And isn't it interesting that something that only appears every 70-something year shows up when repentance is? And what is it? The devil. The devil's coming. Because bright in the sky, in the darkness of that eclipse, bright in the sky will be the devil. I'm telling you, nah, don't believe this. Don't repent. Don't worry about it. I've got this all in control. I'm winning this battle. But the Lord says, that's a defeated foe. And we need to understand it. The devil is all talk and no bite because he has been disarmed. Persecution, famine. Some of us might be going through a little bit of that. But you know what? You can go through famine. And God still feeds you. Ask Israel. Manna in the morning and quail at night. Well, it's not what I like. Too bad. I spoke to somebody this week about nutrition. They need to start eating more nutritiously. Folks, we need to start to eat of the presence of God in a nutritious way, not just take the junk food. Come and get an emotional high on Sunday morning. No, we need something real, something grounded. Nakedness, peril, sword. As it is written, for your sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. For Jesus' sake. For Jesus' sake, we are killed all the day long. You know what that is? That's the attitude of the world and our attitudes of selfishness and sin that need to be killed. That we know better. Church, I'm just going to open up and tell you this. I love every one of you. But some of you have me on my knees more than you know. And the reason being, it's because I'm asking God to cause you to realize what he has for you and everything that he has for you. Because some of you feel like you've been killed and destroyed and useless and lack power. And the devil has lied to you for too long. But I am saying, greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. I am saying, quit counting yourself just a sheep for the slaughter. Quit saying, oh, I'm just doing it for Jesus. No, you don't do it for Jesus. Jesus did it for you. There's a big difference there. The last verse I have, yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through Him who loves us. You are a conqueror this morning. Not just an overcomer, you are a conqueror this morning. Because you didn't overcome anything, Jesus did. And by His overcoming, He made you a conqueror. Isn't that interesting? Jesus did the work, then He gives you the credit. Isn't that a beautiful thing? What do I mean? I'm more than a conqueror. But I'm more than a conqueror, not because of the word conqueror. I'm more than a conqueror through the last five words of this verse, through Him that who loved us. I am more than a conqueror through Him, through Jesus. He loves me. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Understand that. Jesus loves you. He loves you. It doesn't matter who you are. You need to know Him. And as we come out of this Easter season, this resurrection season, and we begin to move, listen to this, for the next 7 weeks, we begin to move into Pentecost, the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit was given. Listen. We need to begin to awake. We need to begin to be alert. We need to begin to pray. We need to begin to be in the Word so that we can be ready when His Spirit comes. And when His Spirit comes, that we might receive His Spirit and be a testimony of who He is within our life. Amen? That's what it's all about. That's what it's all about. That's what He wants to do within our life. Let's pray. Father, we just thank You for Your Word. Open our eyes, Lord, to Your presence. Open our hearts, Lord, to hear. That we're more than a conqueror through You. You've done the work. Nothing can separate us from You. Because, Lord, I thank You that, yes, we attach ourselves to You, but more than that, Father, through Your death and resurrection, You have attached Yourself to us. I thank You for that. I thank You for the reality of, Lord, what You want to do in teaching us to understand that we are not a victim, but we are a victor. That we are victorious in Jesus. You bought us with a price, the price of Your life, that we might be free from the law of sin and death. You attach Yourself to us. As Your bride. In all of our problems, in all of our situations, You still love us. Flawed beings that we are, You don't ask us to become perfect, You just ask us to become willing. Willing to receive you and your presence in a wonderful and mighty way. Father, we just give you praise this morning. That our hearts, Lord, be renewed. Let us proclaim that we are a child of the King. Let us proclaim that there's no condemnation because you've taken it. Let us proclaim, Father, that we are a conqueror because you have gone before us and conquered the land. All we have to do is by faith step into it. Father, we just give you praise and glory for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. Believe who he is real. Tell you, I'm here to pray. I'm praying with you, pray for you.